In general, there are two major methods, that is marriage counseling, and second is prenatal diagnosis. Marriage counseling is simple and cost-effective, but there are some hurdles in it. Prenatal diagnosis, comparatively costly, appears and requires well-established laboratory and expert in the field. However, we found this is more effective, only precaution to be taken, that is niyate anena nidanam, that is accurate diagnosis. Now, I will introduce to Vishwacharya of the Human Genetics in India, Madam Dr. Mrs. Padke, who is former Professor of Pediatrics
सर अनम्यूट कर अनम्यूट काटे सर
एंड लास्टली सी इज आवर मेंटर सो डॉक्टर फड़के मैडम प्लीज
देयर प्रॉब्लम
डियर डॉक्टर काटे सर My mentor too, and president and chairperson of Sudham Kate Research Foundation, Dr. Shamu Kate, Shamu Basu Kate, and all the members of the Kate family, Dr. Prakash Gambhir, my favorite and the best student, I think, who now leads the genetic department. Probably in Pune and also all over India, that his name and fame has gone in genetics everywhere. Dr. Roshan Kola, Dr. Rama Manchanda, and all the members of the organizing committee, and above all, so many obstetricians whom I see who are attending this conference. And I also see one scientist and one professor in this August gathering. They are not only scientists at the Serum Institute and professor in the University of Pune, but they are beneficiaries of the little treatment that could ever be given. And they are, let me mention them. Can I take your names, Dr. Pooja Doshi and Dr. Doshi? With your permission, I take your names because they are the absolute people who have got benefited by Dr. Kate's counseling. So today we have all met here to discuss and deliberate through the Research Foundation on an important topic, and that is the role of obstetricians. Role of obstetricians in detection, diagnosis, and further management of hemoglobinopathies. A subject very close to our heart. Let me mention that 50 years ago, when the incidence of hemoglobinopathies was the same as what it is now, around 3%, Dr. Kate and Dr. G.S. Muttalik founded the genetic department at the BJ Medical College and Sassoon Hospital. And I had the great fortune to work there. Dr. Kate and I established the small genetic department, and Dr. Prakash Gambhir joined it. I may only mention two patients to set the context of the meeting. One patient, I'll again take her name, Rumjum Mitra, a patient of e-thalassemia who took treatment for 40 years. And today she is a very big scientist in the US. And another patient, Zeeshan Ali, who was born and brought up in Pune of a mixed marriage of a girl from Brahmin community married to a Muslim. And unfortunately, both were thalassemia carriers, both parents, and the child was born thalassemia major. Now, with great struggle, these people have reached their 40 and 50 years. But after all, the struggle is immense. And therefore, we must make attempts to diagnose hemoglobinopathies as early as we can. In those days, 40, 50 years ago, Dr. Kate did with a small instrument, he used to perform hemoglobin electrophoresis. And he used to perform that even in Dadgaon and in Gadchiroli. And this is how we used to diagnose sickle cell disease and thalassemia and hemoglobin E and so on. But today science has advanced. And let us see what can we do. Nowadays, I don't do much of genetics since my role with the UNICEF involves something doing with nutrition. And also, of course, nutrition in the tribal areas. And it gives me a little scope to think because we've adopted some government schemes. And I might mention that Government of India has a scheme called as Anemia Mukta Bharat. In this scheme, girls and boys at the age when they go to the fourth standard onwards, means adolescent girls and boys, are given iron treatment, iron and folic acid tablets in the school health program in all municipal and corporation schools all over the state of Maharashtra and in India. Now in this, I think this is the time maybe when we will be able to detect hemoglobinopathies, because if the hemoglobin of these girls and boys does not rise, but that is rarely done because to make the program a success itself is taking time. So this is probably not the right time for us to diagnose hemoglobinopathies. The second one is, can we do it before marriage? I think marriages in India are probably made in heaven and they are so difficult that the brunt of it will be borne by girls. Just now on TV every day we are seeing only gruesome pictures of what is the scenario of women in India. And if we add one more, and that is detection of hemoglobinopathies, I think our fate will be even further worse fate of girls in India. So what are we left with? We are left with one choice, and that is in the hands of obstetricians. It's the obstetricians who can perform prenatal diagnosis, who can perform counseling, and who can do lots of things. So if a girl or if a woman who is thinking of conception and has conceived just around 8 weeks, she could be the right candidate to find out whether she is a thalassemia trait. And then maybe the partner or the husband, one could test that as well. And if both are thalassemia trait, we may advocate prenatal diagnosis. The same thing could be done for sickle cell disease. And the same thing could be done for more serious hemoglobinopathies and so on. So this is probably the obstetrician is best suited. But obstetricians are extremely busy and they have to do antenatal screening of so many things. Not only are they going to screen for RH, not only are they going to screen for syphilis, and not only are they going to do HIV, not only are they going to do cytomegalo and toxoplasma and so many other diseases, but I think the prevalence of hemoglobinopathies, particularly in India and in Maharashtra, is quite high. And so today is the time. So let me congratulate Dr. Kate wholeheartedly for number one, setting up this research foundation, and Shamu for starting one first webinar, which is on prenatal detection and diagnosis of hemoglobinopathies and what the obstetricians can do. I think the role is 100% of that of an obstetrician. So I hope the message goes to Pune and to all the obstetricians, and we are all very ready to listen to it. And science is going to advance only if we all work hard. So in the end, I will tell you only two stories. One, how science has advanced. And that was when I was reading on COVID, I realized that thalassemia trait individuals do not get COVID so easily.
Yes.
A protection that they get, just the way malaria and just the way sickle cell trait offers protection against malaria. We think that COVID, probably thalassemia traits don't get it. But that's just an observation and a hypothesis. But the research that I want to tell you is, Dr. Kate, 40 years ago, told me, and it is befitting now that we are having Dr. Kate's Research Foundation. 40 years ago, he told me, Madam, when I'm treating patients of sickle cell disease in Dadgaon, and if I give them the inside magaj of the bale fur, the inside, the gur, as
pulp,
we say,
pulp,
bale fur, the pulp. If you give the pulp of bale fur, these children improve. So I nearly laughed. I said, how can that happen? He told me that they don't get sickle cell crisis. He said their hemoglobin rises. And I said, what are you telling me, Kate? How can that happen? But when I saw it myself, when I went to Dadgaon and he showed me, I realized, and even the children told us that they don't get sickle cell crisis, how they were getting. And they were eating the balats of fur, the pulp, the inside of the bale fur, which is given to Lord Shankar. So I said, let me do it. And then I gave it to Dr. Nilima Kshirsagar, my sister who works in pharmacology, who then was the pharmacology professor. And also with her link with ICMR, which still is there, she analyzed bale fur and we found out that it contains urea. And urea is indeed a treatment for sickle cell disease.
Right.
So let me congratulate Dr. Kate for his research. Probably many of you don't even know about it. So it could be that only a handful of us remember it. Kati, do you remember it?
Yeah.
Yes. So that is bale fur. And I think Dr. Gambhir was also a witness to it. So once again, I wholeheartedly congratulate Dr. S.L. Kate and the Sudham Kate Research Foundation for undertaking such a good task for forming his research foundation. And Dr. Sharmila Basu, and then all of us who are attending this small webinar, I wish good luck to everybody. And now we are very keen to listen to Dr. Prakash Gambhir, who now, Kate sir, from one mentor, I have changed my mentor, and now it is Dr. Prakash Gambhir. So I'm ready to listen to you, Dr. Gambhir.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much. But without your blessings, we can't go ahead. So keep your blessings firmly on our heads.
Of course, they are there.
Thank you, ma'am. Dr. Prakash Gambhir is the former professor and head Department of Genetics, Immunology and Biochemistry, Maharashtra University of Health Sciences. He first started an interdisciplinary course in medical genetics. He is MD Pediatrics Gold Medalist and a recipient of many rewards. Presently director of Birthright Genetic Clinic, Pune. Also is a chief medical scientist at LifeCell and a secretary genetics chapter of Indian Academy of Pediatrics. He has more than 40 publications. He is a reviewer for journals like BMJ, Indian Pediatrics, ISHG Journal, in Journal of Genetics of Perinatology, and more. Dr. Gambhir, to you now. I welcome you, Dr. Gambhir. The platform is with you now.
Thank you. Thank you, Sharmila. First of all, I am honored as well as humbled to be here with you. And Sharmila, you forgot two of the greatest qualifications that I have.
And yes, sir. Sorry, sir.
Those two qualifications are that I am taught by Dr. Kate sir and Dr. Phadke madam.
So
these are actually the biggest points in my CV, and I carry them very proudly, very humbly in my CV and what is my life. So today you have given me opportunity to talk in front of Dr. Kate sir and Dr. Phadke madam. Itha sagle marathi chet marathi bhi bolto zara
manje
vithal vithalacha kirtan karava आणि विठ्ठलच कीर्तनाला असावा असं आता कैसं झालेलं आहे. आणि मॅडम म्हणाले की माझे तुम्ही बोलणार तुम्ही ऐकताय म्हणून. मॅडम ज्ञानेश्वरी मध्ये ज्ञानेश्वर म्हणतात प्रत्येक अध्यायामध्ये जवळजवळ की मुलाचे बोल बोबडे असतात पण ते आईला ऐकायला नेहमी आवडतात. तसं मॅडम यू आर माय अकॅडमिक मदर, त्याच्यामुळे मी जे आता बोलणार आहे थोड्यास माझ्या नक्की काहीतरी चुका होतील तर सगळ्या तुम्ही त्या मानून घ्या की माझे ते बोबडे बोल आहेत म्हणून माझे प्रयत्न हे तुमच्या आणि काटे सरांच्या गायडन्स खाली नेहमी चालू राहतील. वन थिंग दॅट आय विल लाईक टू ऍक्च्युली इम्बाइब माय लाईफ ऍटलीस्ट 10% व्हॉट काटे सर इज लिव्हिंग हिमसेल्फ फॉर थ्रू आउट हिज लाईफ अँड दॅट इज हिज सिंगल माइंडेड डेडिकेशन टू द कॉज ऑफ ट्रायबल्स. I remember then when he was awarded Padma Shri at his age, where he was interviewed, I think most of you must have seen him on the compound of a farm on his way to Dhadgaon. So still at his age, even after having knee transplants, he is going to Dhadgaon. And sir, if I have 10% of your dedication, I will be doing justice to my patients to the fullest extent that I've been taught by you and Dr. Phadke. So with this simple tribute to you, I will continue with my talk. And it is regarding hemoglobinopathy screening in clinical practice. I have chosen here the words in clinical practice because I am, over the years, have been an interface between gynecologists and the patients in bringing them the knowledge of genetics as well as techniques that are in laboratory to the culmination of prenatal diagnosis and prevention of thalassemias as well as hemoglobinopathies. So whatever I've been taught by Dr. Kate sir, Dr. Phadke madam, I am trying to bring it into practice. And now I got this opportunity of serving with live cell. And live cell, I must mention here, is the biggest probably laboratory which is screening more than 10,000 patients with double marker test, triple marker test per month, as well as it is screening almost 10,000 newborns per month, which comes to the yearly number of more than 1 lakh newborns or 1 lakh couples. We are also doing projects like, say, Madhya Pradesh government and other governments in thalassemia as well as hemoglobinopathy screening. So here, what I like about LiveCell is that we are trying to bring the techniques at a very affordable cost to the patients which are suited to our particular practice environment so that more and more patients get benefit of the screening and the modern genetics that is there. So today I will be talking about why universal screening that is there should be there practiced by a gynecologist. I'll be also briefly talking about methods briefly because I got two great experts, Dr. Manchanda Madam and Dr. Roshan Kola coming after me. So they are the authorities in this laboratory methods as well as implementing them in practice. I will try to say a few points more vehemently why integrating DNA methods with our routine screening methods in few number of visits is very mandatory and of how we are practicing reflex screening in our laboratory. I will also say that the gynecologist has got a very important role in all these steps, as well as cascade screening for thalassemias, as well as hemoglobinopathies. I must say here for the gynecologist that you are the key specialist in prevention of hemoglobinopathies and thalassemias, and without you, the prevention program will never meet its success. But my talk is based on three documents in chief, and that is first is the very detailed guidelines that have been prepared by National Health Mission in 2016-17. It is available freely on their website. I'll also be taking support of bulletin of World Health Organization written by Dr. Bernadette Model, a great lady who is involved in modeling statistics as well as hemoglobinopathies as well as genetic disorders. I'll also be taking resort to a paper which was very interesting and which was published in BMJ, which is an audit which concerns the failure to give the couples at risk the chance to have prenatal diagnosis. I'm taking this paper purposefully because we who are practicing in metros are actually all the facilities with us, but the patients are not availing the facilities as well as the expertise to the extent that is there. So I'll go through this paper so as to give voice to the unmet needs of the patients and how we can approach them with new patient-suited, practice-suited strategies which are fit for our country. I must tell you that there are success stories here. So successful prevention programs against hemoglobinopathies have been implemented in many countries. These are small countries. Our countries have got a greater challenge. So in Cyprus, the prevalence of thalassemias, as we know, beta thalassemia is almost zero. In Sardinia also, it has decreased to almost 90%. And Canada, the adolescent screening program, is supposed to be the best program in the world. And it has led to 95% decrease in births of children with hemoglobinopathies. So why this is possible? This is possible because of carrier screening, essentially. So when we screen carriers, then we know which couple is at risk of having the thalassemia or hemoglobinopathies. And then you can have a simple prenatal diagnosis and prevent it in antenatal practice. So this is the whole aim of having a good antenatal screening program with the help of gynecologists so that we can get rid of the birth of thalassemic children. Now, just to brush up our knowledge a little bit, the hemoglobin molecules is made up of hem part as well as the globin part. Globin part is the protein part, and these are the globin chains. There are two types of globin chains. One is the alpha type of globin chains, which are on the alpha gene cluster, which is present on the 16th chromosome, and the beta globin gene cluster. And the hemoglobins that we see in adults is mainly hemoglobin A. Fetal hemoglobin is made of two alpha and two gamma chains. And hemoglobin A2 is present in a certain proportion in adults, but in carriers, because hemoglobin A is there present in lower amounts, you get higher proportion of hemoglobin A2. So that is why hemoglobin A2 is used for carrier detection. Now, hemoglobinopathies, we can classify them into two broad categories. One is the structural hemoglobinopathies, where there is sequence variation giving rise to abnormal hemoglobins like sickle cell hemoglobin or hemoglobin D Punjab or hemoglobin E, and thalassemias. In thalassemias, there is no sequence change, but in thalassemias, the rate of chain synthesis is less. So that less of globin is formed, and so that there is anemia. So depending on the which chain is involved, we call it either alpha thalassemia or beta thalassemia. In our country, we are more concerned with the sickle cell anemia, as well as hemoglobin E, as well as beta thalassemia. So the mutation rate of these globin chains is at a fixed rate. It is present in all populations. So when we screen all the world population, we'll find that the sickle cell or hemoglobin or hemoglobinopathy traits are present 1:1,000. That is the ratio that is prevalent in almost all the populations. But they're much more common in tropics and subtropics, where malaria was common and survival advantage was offered in the heterozygous stage, because these particular RBCs were resistant to lysis by falciparum malaria, which is a severe form of malaria. Now, as Dr. Patke Madam had said, maybe if COVID offering protection, maybe the problem of hemoglobinopathies will be more in coming years if COVID persists with us. So we don't know what is happening to COVID, but COVID definitely tells us that number of visits to hospitals are very difficult and they should be less. So we must actually try and implement that in our practice as much as possible. So recent data suggests that about 7% of all world population has some gene which is in heterozygous state for a hemoglobinopathy or a thalassemia. There are almost 1 lakh children are born every year all over the world, and they're homozygous for thalassemia. And more than 65 to 70,000 children are supposed to be there in India. In every year, the NHM document says that almost 15 to 20,000 children are born with thalassemia in our country. The prevalence of the thalassemia gene and hemoglobinopathies varies. So sickle cell gene in some of the pockets of the tribal district, Kattesar has told, that some villages have a heterozygote incidence for sickle cell as high as 40 to 50%. But there's thalassemia trait is also common in certain communities, which my co-speakers will be talking about. But this was beautifully told in each and every lecture that Kattesar took for us when I was an undergraduate or postgraduate. And he had an acronym called DESH, which was there for learning the distribution of hemoglobinopathies and thalassemias all over India. So D stands for hemoglobin D, which is common in the western part of our country. E stands for the hemoglobin E in the eastern part of the seven sister states, as well as the Bengal and the Odisha region. The S part is common in the central part and the southern part, but H stands for the hemoglobinopathies, that is thalassemias. They're common all over the India, and the rate for average rate of thalassemia state is around 3%. So important thing to remember here, that carriers or the heterozygote carriers for all these hemoglobinopathies are asymptomatic. Now, there are different strategies that Dr. Fatke Madam has told, as well as Kate sir has told, that we can have marriage counseling, we can have preconception counseling, we can have premarital counseling, we can have preconceptional as well as antenatal, and we can practice cascade screening. I must say here that gynecologist is the key specialist for implementing the genetic technologies as well as all these the preventive programs. So that is why gynecologist, I'm very happy to hear that I'm speaking here in front of gynecologists, because they are the tools through which the fruits of the modern genetics will reach the needy thalassemic patient. Here, as I told you, I'm going to resort to the BMJ paper that was there, and it was a very frank and very candid audit that was carried out, not in last century, but in the present century, at the beginning of present century. So what does this audit say? Here you can see that there are 138 pregnancies in the first pregnancy, their primary patients were at risk for thalassemia. Out of them, even in NHS, where they got a systematic program, 68 women were only aware they did avail the prenatal diagnosis. Rest of them missed prenatal diagnosis in spite of all their coverage, all their less number of patients, all the technology, counseling methods, and everything. Here again, different communities have different acceptance levels. So you can see here that the people from Cyprus, they avail prenatal diagnosis to the tune of 81%. Indian fared a little better in first pregnancy, 50%. But the Pakistanis as well as Bangladeshis that are present in UK, they avail little least. Now consider all pregnancies here. That is, these pregnancies had a previous child with thalassemia. Here again, if you consider in total, many of them missed prenatal diagnosis, even though the technology was available, the expertise was available. So the uptake of prenatal diagnosis, even for these women, was just 67%. Again, in spite of all the communication that goes on there. So here, the important word for all of us is to learn is to have proper communication, proper counseling with the needy patients. Awareness is required, as well as sensitivity is required, because there are different communities. This is more applicable to our country, because all the things that we are going to be there, I remember Dr. Kate telling me that people hide their cards when they go to a for marriage or when they go to a clinic, because they are afraid of stigmatization of the sickle cell carrier status. So that is why this awareness, when it percolates to the needy person, then this sort of stigmatization will not be there. And whatever expertise is available with us, it will be availed totally by the patients. Now here I have actually purposefully, again, going through a little detail through this paper to know the causes why the particular prenatal diagnosis was not availed by the patients. Here you see they have labeled this as unavoidable because there were three atypical results which did not characterize the pregnancies at risk of having a thalassemia trait. Now three husbands were unavailable. Why they called this unavoidable, I don't know. They could have been traced. Late presentation of pregnancy, again, a form of miscommunication. Now, just look here, 28% of the missed prenatal diagnosis, the women were not screened at all. So they missed the screening. So they were not characterized as hemoglobin, the thalassemia carriers. Now, laboratory area, again, this is an avoidable thing. It was there in 12% of cases. Husbands were not tested in 23% of cases. Now, in our country also, in metros, I practice in Pune mostly. So here also we see the similar scenario. So that is why miscommunication has to be avoided totally. So we should be offering tests to all women. And by all women, I don't mean only the women at risk of thalassemia. All women, we must consider them to be at risk of thalassemia or hemoglobinopathy. Not tracing the husband, we must tell every woman that if she's a carrier, the husband has to be there for the further testing. And so all this will not delay the prenatal diagnosis, which our law actually mandates us to have within 20 weeks of pregnancy, that with some more leeway with the determination period now. And we must avoid the laboratory error. So good laboratory practices must be availed to present. Also, we must have strategies which are more suited to our country. So how to have effective antenatal screening in clinical practice? All these steps are important. First is universal screen for all antenatal women, Second thing, we must employ a good test. A thorough pretest counsel is required. So this is test that we are going to do is not the end of the study, but the test may be required for prevention of thalassemia. We must, as much as possible, should reduce number of visits, because more number of visits will lead to more miscommunication, more missing of the diagnosis. We must tell every woman that tracing husband is important, and then screen her. And this will able to, us to offer prenatal diagnosis and a proper nick of time. So NHM's the study for prevention of this document says there should be initial screening, which means of a simple test, which can, it's a very sensitive test, which has got a very good negative predictivity, and at the most it is very cheap. So it can be offered because our resources are less. We must utilize our resources to the as economically as possible. So this is the first screen that NHS advises. Then who are positive for this particular screen, NHS says that they should go in for hemoglobin fraction studies by HPLC. Those who are having carrier status, then they should be actually going undergoing the DNA based test. So at the best, this particular thing will become a three-step diagnosis to the carrier status and maybe prenatal diagnosis after the husband did test. Now, in our effective antenatal diagnosis, what we should have, we should not have the spot test, because spot test, again, three spots, because what we have seen is that, for example, in Pune, previously there used to be less number of sickle cell anemia patients, less number of hemoglobin E patients, but now the migration is going on. Our country is having a lot of, the Pune and the people are coming here for various reasons, especially for jobs. And then we are getting people from east of country, the west of our country, as well as the sickle cell patients. So we must have a good diagnosis with the help of HPLC at the initial stage only. Mutation diagnosis can be coupled with it, and we should test the husband as early as possible. So economic, this thing we can have is with the help of this one is a strategy which was there, where which, this I used to advise about 10 years ago for preconception as well as antenatal counseling, is that the receptionist in the gynecologist office from the hemoglobin indices, she can actually, in a patient with anemia or microcytosis, can calculate the Menzer index and segregate patients into iron deficiency patients and those who are having thalassemia trait. Only those who are suspected to have thalassemia trait can undergo HPLC studies. But again, as I told you, this is not very practical because this can have lacunes of miscommunication, more number of visits. So what we should have as the HPLC as well studies or capillary electrophoresis studies in all pregnant women, because this particular Menzer index strategy will not be covering the hemoglobinopathy patients, that is sickle cell patients as well as hemoglobin E patients. So when we have a HPLC study or a capillary electrophoresis study, we will be covering all hemoglobinopathies that are possible in India. And when it is coupled with good indices, we'll have iron deficiency also covered, as well as we'll be able to do justice to all the possibilities, all the causes of anemia that are present in a pregnant woman. So that is why we should have indices as well as this HPLCs as well as this characterization studies. Now, I will be talking a little bit in detail regarding the strategy that we have been practicing in our labs, and that is the reflex hemoglobinopathy studies. So usual study in what happens is that the lady comes first to the obstetrician, and he then does her hemogram and all that first antenatal checkup, and then he advises at the same time HPLC studies. Now these HPLC studies, when they are showing raised A2 or they are showing the hemoglobin urea, hemoglobin S, then this woman is again called back, then she is counseled, the second sample is taken, and then it is sent for the mutation studies or molecular characterization. Now this requires 3 or 4 visits, and at the most, at the quickest, we can have results regarding mutation within, say, 2 weeks of time. After she is found to be a carrier, then we call the husband, then we find whether he's a carrier or he's not a carrier, then again characterizes mutations. So all this actually delays the timing of prenatal diagnosis. So to avoid that, in what do we do in our lab, and I think it is suited in India, is that we advise reflex testing. So every woman who comes to antenatal clinic, we have her indices studied, as well as we do her capillary ectophoresis. And if she's found to be carrier for any hemoglobinopathy or thalassemia state, then what we do is that we do her mutation diagnosis from the same sample. So the woman does not have to come to clinic once again and give one more sample for DNA diagnosis. So we have reduced the number of visits as well as we have prenatal diagnosis in time. I'll just give you this particular sample picture. This is actual sample, which was collected in the month of May. So it was, the sample was collected from a district place in Maharashtra on 22nd of May. And on 24th of May, it reached our laboratories. On the 25th of May, the lady was found to be and reported to be carrier for thalassemia state. From the same sample, we characterized by the means of Sanger sequencing the beta globin gene mutation, which was responsible for carrier state. And you will see here that the mutation characterization report was available on the 2nd of June. So only one day was required in lab for characterization, 3 days from the drawing of the sample and reporting of the sample. And only 7 days were required where we could actually report the mutation. So here, the obstetricians will have very easy time because they will have their time on their hands to implement the prenatal diagnosis by calling the husband, studying his blood. And from his blood also, we'll be having reflex reporting. So the timing for the actual the characterization for both mutations, if the husband is also carrier, will be very less. So this is what we advise. And probably this is probably suited for COVID times all over the world and more suited in our country because our distances are far and many, so that we must have prenatal diagnosis disease as less as possible. So this is the power of genetics reflex testing. Okay, I must remind our obstetrician colleagues that we must have cascade screening. Our counseling for any patient, now that lady may just be a heterozygote carrier or she may be related to some thalassemia patient, but her brothers, her sisters are likely to be thalassemia carriers. So if a lady is a carrier, then there is 50% chance that her brother or sister is also a carrier for thalassemia state or a sickle cell heterozygote. There is 50% chance of her sister or brother may be a carrier for sickle cell anemia. So that is why all first order relatives and their first order relatives must be actually tested for carrier status. And this is what is called as cascade screening. So your counseling for any lady, any carrier or a patient is not finished unless you practice cascade screening. So test all first order relatives of carrier lady or a thalassemia patient's parents. So just to summarize, if we want to have effective hemoglobinopathy screening in clinical practice in India, these are the steps that are essential. First of all, we must screen all women that are coming to our antenatal clinic. Second thing, we must have a very thorough prenatal pretest counseling, telling them what we are going to study. At the same time, we must tell them that if they are found to be carriers, then the husband has got to be here. And if both are carriers, then we will have a prenatal diagnosis. We must integrate mutation testing in the initial screen itself so that our counseling is also easy and the number of visits will be less and the prenatal diagnosis can be reached in time. So this is the strategy that is, should be practiced in our country according to me, so that in practice there will not be any further cases as we have seen in that NHS paper. There will not be any missed opportunities for prenatal diagnosis. So thank you everybody.
Thank you, Dr. Gambhir. It was indeed an eye-opener for a lay person like me. Thank you so much. We will be taking the question answers at the end of the session. Be tuned.
We go Dr. Prakash Gambhir. Excellent.
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you, madam.
We go to our next...
Congratulations, Dr. Prakash.
Thanks, sir. Thank you very much, sir.
Stay tuned, sir. We will be getting back to a lot of questions which are in the chat box. I go to the next speaker, Dr. Ruma Manchanda. Ma'am, good evening. Have you logged in, ma'am?
Can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am. Good afternoon.
Sorry for the initial glitch. And Dr. Gambhir, I'm sorry, missed half of your presentation. I hope there are no overlaps in this. But yes, thank you, Dr. Kate. Thank you, Sharmila.
Ma'am, I would like to quickly introduce you to the audience.
Okay.
Yeah. Dr. Ruma Manchanda completed a medical graduation and postgraduation, that is MD pathology, from Lady Hardin Medical College, New Delhi. She is a renowned hematologist, a gold medalist with specialization in hematopathology, and currently holds the post of Professor and Director, Pathology, KM Hospital, Pune. Her immense clinical experience and skills have been an asset to institutions and the nation in many ways. Her dedication, hard work, and excellent contribution in the field of hematology has been further extended to her continued active teaching activities. She is a member of many prestigious professional bodies and societies, notable amongst them being the International Society of Laboratory Hematology. Her main research interest is in the area of neonatal and pediatric hematology. Welcome, ma'am, and over to you.
Thank you, Sharmila. Thank you so much. I'm just opening my presentation. I hope it is visible to everybody.
Yes, ma'am.
I'll go full screen.
Yeah, ma'am.
Is this clear enough?
Madam, you have to start with the screen sharing option.
Okay, sorry. I'll go back. Okay. I did screen share.
Here from the screen share, you will see your PowerPoint there. You can select that. Select screen.
Yeah, it's share screen, but it's not active. It's not. What could be the problem?
Okay, you want me to share it from my end?
Yeah, because I'm doing share screen, but that prompt is not opening.
No problem. I'll start the screen sharing.
Try now. There we are. Is that okay? And I must see the...
Ma'am, can't see the slide still.
I know.
Yeah, now you are seeing. Now it goes. Now you choose PowerPoint.
Okay.
Now you have to open your file.
Yes. It was actually open, but I don't know why it's asking me to open it again, but here I am.
Yes.
I go full screen?
Yes.
Okay. Is that okay?
Perfect.
Yes, ma'am.
All right. Thank you so much. Perfect. Thanks a lot, Sharmila, Dr. Kate, for inviting me to be part of this. Dr. Phadke, it was nice for you to be there. I am going to share some of my thoughts on the antenatal screening. I'm sorry, Dr. Gambhir, I missed the initial part of your presentation. So I hope there are no overlaps on this. I'm just going to stress why it is important that the antenatal screening should be done by the obstetricians. Routine screening, we do the hemogram, blood groups, do the 1 hour post glucose, HIV, HBS, AG, VDRL, urine routine, and double and triple marker. As we know, this is the usual package for all the antenatal screening. However, I have put these three, HIV, HBS, AG, and VDRL in red, because look at the incidence of these. They are less than 1% or less than 4%, but we are giving importance to these instead of giving importance to something else, which in our population is in a higher percentage. Hemoglobin, as has been discussed probably, we know the different types. This is in the hemoglobin in the embryonic, fetal, and the adult. And the switchover takes place at the birth from the fetal hemoglobin to the adult hemoglobin. And that is the switch taking place at the time of birth. By 6 months, this switch is complete and we have more of adult hemoglobin than the fetal hemoglobin. Adult hemoglobin, we all know, is made up of two beta and two alpha chains, and that constitutes with the heme pockets sitting there. Now, hemoglobinopathies, we have discussed, are the disorders of human hemoglobin. Either it's abnormal production or there is a structural hemoglobin molecule which is defective. Important ones or common variants are listed here, which we are interested in, and most of the top ones are the ones which are seen in Indian population. I'm sure this has been discussed by Dr. Gambhir, how the inheritance of thalassemia occurs because it's an autosomal recessive disorder. I won't go into the detail of that. Hemoglobinopathy and thalassemias constitute a major bulk of inherited blood diseases in India, and they cause a high degree of morbidity. And moderate to severe hemolytic anemia, it is caused by these disorders among infants, children, adolescent girls, pregnant women, and it causes several deaths in India. Obstetrician friends, you are seeing these newborns. How many of you have met the children that you have delivered a year before? Very few of you, I'm sure. Many of which may be tied up for life to a blood transfusion canal like this, because they have not inherited the normal hemoglobin. They have inherited either a sickle or a thalassemic profile, and which was never tested earlier to prevent the birth or to please be prepared for a child like this. This is Thal Major, 11-year-old girl with a huge hepatosplenomegaly, which could have been detected earlier and in the antenatal period if the parents were screened. This is the status of these children. They are hooked on to these for life, because somebody never tested these parents for the inherited hemoglobinopathy. We know that thalassemia, major management is basically supportive in the form of blood transfusions. There are some curative options and there are some preventive options. The basic supportive care is to maintain the packed cell volume, hemoglobin, above 9 grams. It needs blood transfusion every 3 weeks to 1 month. And on top of that, we have to iron chelate these to keep the ferritin below 2000 nanograms per milliliter. Look at the cost. The total cost may go above 70,000 per year for a child, per year. Now the child has to live, you can imagine how many years, and it could go on adding to the cost of these tests and maintenance. On top of that, the regular blood transfusions have certain complications. They may transmit viral infections. 18 to 20% positivity is there. Antibody production, which may be to antibodies to RBCs, HLA, or platelets. immediate reactions are there in mainly 30% of the children. And of course, hypersplenism added on to this worsens the blood requirement in these cases. This blood transfusions leads to accumulation of iron, causing hemosiderosis in these children. The complications of hemosiderosis are many. It can deposit in different organs and cause end organ damage, cause endocrine, hepatic, cardiac, skin and bones, and many other organ pathology. Other problems of supportive therapy, as I said, is the cost. Look at the cost that each couple is facing every year because of the blood transfusions, which are very uncomfortable also, has a risk of infections and causes poor growth if it is not adequately transfused. If adequate chelation is not there, iron deposition can occur, can lead to early diabetes, liver cell failure, endocrine problems, and cardiac failure in these children. Look what all can happen to a small baby if not really caught early or prevented this whole scenario. Problems in beta thal, others are because they can be diagnosed early and can be managed properly if excellent quality of life can be given if they are managed properly. The basic problems with regular transfusions and related complications are the iron overload, the finances, many social problems. The family is running all the time arranging the blood transfusion in the hospital, and it leads to a whole lot of complications. Other problems that may be there due to regular blood transfusions, it is uncomfortable to go through these transfusions. Blood is not easily available and you have a lot of unavailability. What is the safety of these blood products that they are taking? They are running to the hospitals to arrange for the transfusions, leads to loss of employment, loss of education, and that is the social scenario. There are certain cures available, which is in the form of a stem cell transplant, either from a bone marrow, peripheral blood, or umbilical cord, related unmatched related donor, or MUD, what we call as matched unrelated donor. But it is very expensive, can go up to 10 to 12 lakhs of rupees. How many of our families can afford this? Prevention is the best thing that we can do in our population and in our scenario. Before 16th week of pregnancy, or best at 9th week, these are the three important techniques which can be used: chorionic villus sampling, fetal blood sampling, or amniocentesis for the prenatal diagnosis. WHO estimates that 7% of world population is a carrier of hemoglobin disorders. Imagine 7%. Between 1 to 17% in different populations in India itself. Average comes to 3.3, maybe on the higher side, up to 5% in certain communities. It's a huge burden of hemoglobinopathies in India. Prospective prevention through population screening, genetic counseling is the best way possible to prevent these disorders. Prevention is what we must target at. Prevalence of these hemoglobin disorders is the risk of being a carrier varies with ethnicity. Alpha thalassemia is most prevalent among these countries and these communities, whereas beta thalassemia is very prevalent in the Middle East, Southeast Asian countries, Indian subcontinent, and Southeast Asia. Sickle cell disease is very common in certain pockets of India, Madhya Maharashtra, Pakistan, South America, Caribbean, and whole lot of other countries. Pakistan has, imagine, 5.6% incidence of beta thalassemia. That is the red belt, which is the one which is the thalassemia belt in the world. It is very uncommon in South India. Probably it's from the Aryans which have come and the Alexander did not cross Vindhyas. It's common in Aryan descents and anybody can have thalassemia. High frequency of hemoglobin D we see in the north in the Punjabi population. Hemoglobin E in the eastern region of India. HbS reported from populations of tribal origin in different parts of our country. Mass screening. What is the need and why should we do it? Because carrier detection is possible. Pick up beta thal and other thalassemia carriers. Reduce the burden on the health system. Family concern and a lot of social aspect in these children. To pick up carriers, there are primary screenings which are available, which are basic hematological parameters, which Dr. Gambhir has also pointed out. And then there are secondary screens, which are by doing the Hb electrophoresis or HbLC to look for the quantitative or the structural variants. Complete blood counts from symptomatic patients having anemia or asymptomatic patients with abnormal red cell indices and HbH variants are all there for us to find out and to categorize these patients for carrier selection. What is the problem of screening? It is basically at the obstetric level. So my sincere request to all our obstetricians is to pay attention to these disorders in your couples. We have unborn child which is being managed by the obstetrician. Birth of a second beta thal major is very unfortunate. And if they are referred after 18th week, then also there is a problem. Lot of misconceptions are there around the thalassemias and hemoglobinopathies, which have to be cleared by a lot of social organizations. We have obstetricians sending for umbilical cord cell storage, which takes precedence over the thalassemia and hemoglobinopathy screening, which is very unfortunate. If they can spend so much money for storage of umbilical cord cells, then a simple test like beta thal screen or a thalassemia screen should be definitely done in the antenatal period. It is really unfortunate. If you look carefully, we have 18 families with more than one child with beta thal major because somebody has not paid attention to the first thal major and counseling has not been done. We have a pediatrician gynecologist couple with a beta thal major child. How unfortunate. How unfortunate. There are three IVF children with beta thal major. Imagine what all they have gone through to have a child, IVF, and to produce a beta thal major child. Somebody is not really thinking about the genetic screening and counseling. What are the problems in carrier screening? Because you are going to target asymptomatic population, they are not interested. They say, we are fine, we have no problem. So your target audience is very asymptomatic population. Lack of awareness. There is no awareness even in educated people, which is very unfortunate. Mindset of people to spend money on this particular test is not there still. And that is due to poor exposure of our medical faculty, who must understand, especially the gynecologists and the obstetrician, why it is important to test these couples. Because every anemia cannot be deficiency anemia, and RBC indices have to be interpreted properly by us pathologists, so that we give our interpretation to the clinician whom to test. And there are certain indications in the RBC indices. Normal hemoglobin people doesn't mean that they cannot carry a hemoglobinopathy. So these are certain problems, and these are certain misconceptions which are there in our mindset. What is the cost of a screening program? First of all, the manpower. To train people, it's not so difficult. We have more number of people who are being trained now to pick up these disorders. What is the testing cost? 1100 rupees against 75,000 per year throughout the life of that child. 1100 can prevent the birth of a child like that. Saving of agony, financial burden of the individual and the society, poor quality of life, and a fruitful life led by a person and family contributes back to the society. I think the government should also pay more attention for these disorders to be screened and make it mandatory part of the obstetrics or the antenatal checkup at the first time when the couple comes, when the woman is pregnant. What is the objective? To pick up beta thal carriers in the community, counsel these couples which are at risk, and remove the ethnic fear about these carriers. We have to implement a model like the Cyprus model. A lot of non-profit making programs are there which are trying to do it, and this can contribute to social structure. Improve the voluntary blood donation so that you can service those who need these blood transfusions. Some smaller countries have reported no newborns with this disease. Birth rate of homozygous beta thalassemia in different parts of the world have reduced considerably. This has been achieved due to control programs, population surveys, antenatal diagnosis, increasing awareness in the medical profession. Absolutely necessary. Population by large, everybody for in the educational institutes and counselings. Nationwide sickle cell program in Cuba has reported detecting these in the prenatal diagnosis program. Blood samples were obtained from the mothers. They attended for prenatal care, and the couple which was one of the mother was positive, the couple was given an appointment for a genetic center where the fathers were counseled and told why it is important that he should also get tested. Although counseling was non-directive, the decisions made by these couples, the program reduced the number of newborns with sickle cell disease by 30%. Imagine how much burden it has decreased in that country. Screening for pregnant women will detect a significant number of individuals who do not know that they have sickle or hemoglobin, any other hemoglobinopathies. So if obstetricians do not screen for hemoglobinopathies, they are at risk for medical malpractice. I must warn them, legal cases can come to these obstetricians for not testing, because nowadays couples are educated. They can file legal cases against you if you do not test them and inform them or give a choice to them for an antenatal test. Many obstetricians and health workers who fail to inform about these genetic disorders in groups are at high risk to expose themselves to the wrongful birth suits, which has happened in many countries. On the other hand, informed consent is absolutely necessary for genetic programs in the present day-to-day medical decision making. Genetic tests have to be they are invading not only the privacy of an individual, but also of that family. We must keep it in mind. The door of a disclosure of non-paternity is also open. So these are the side effects of antenatal testing also. Insurance companies, if they know that you have certain hemoglobinopathies, they may reduce your claim, or they cause restriction or denial or termination of an individual's policy or family coverage. So these are some of the problems that is the flip side of antenatal screening. So there have been debates on whether screen high school children, college students, along with thalassemia programs. Will it succeed in India? We don't know. The question also remains whether high school children screened and counseled will be sensitive to the information regarding thalassemia. Whether they would remember that is another question. At the time of marriage, I'm sure they don't want to talk about it. Neither the family nor that person would like to talk about this status when it is going to be an arranged marriage system, which is common in India still. Premarital screening in Indian population, that is why, is still considered controversial and may not happen for a long time. So coming to the end of my talk, beta thalassemia is a great, or all hemoglobinopathies are a great burden to the society. With proper screening, educative program, genetic counseling, we can prevent the birth of a thal major or any other hemoglobin homozygous child. Prevention is definitely better than transfusions. Thank you so much. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, ma'am. I'm really scared that we have to go a long way with the awareness.
Absolutely. We have a long way to go in India.
Correct. There are a few questions which we'll be taking at the end of the session.
Sure.
Remain tuned, ma'am.
Sure.
Our next speaker is Dr. Roshan Kola. Good evening, ma'am. Are you there?
Good evening. Yes, I'm there. Good evening.
I'll quickly introduce you. Dr. Roshan Kola is the former director in charge and scientist G, ICMR, Indian Institute of Immunohematology, Mumbai. She is a world expert in medical genetics, especially in molecular genetics of hemoglobinopathies. She is a PhD in biochemistry from Bombay University and completed further postdoctoral training in hemoglobinopathies from Athens, London, and Paris. She is a recipient of prestigious WHO and French government fellowships. Her awards and honors are many and dignified, notable among them being the ICMR Kanishk Award, Women Scientist Award for Organization of Pharmaceutical Producers of India. Sorry, from Organizations of Pharmaceutical Producers of India. Dr. J.G. Parekh Award, and the Living Legend Award of the Mumbai Hematology Society. Dr. Kola was instrumental in creating national capacity in the area of hemoglobinopathies through her contributions in newborn screening programs, sickle cell disease network, and developing the national policy on hemoglobinopathies. She has many peer reviewed publications and book chapters to her credit. Over to you, ma'am. Dr. Kola, over to you.
Yes.
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you, Sharmila. Can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
Can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. And it is indeed a pleasure to be a part of this first webinar of Dr. Kate's Research Foundation, especially for me because I've been associated with Dr. Kate for over 40 years. So I'll take you through some of the problems we face in prenatal diagnosis and control of hemoglobinopathies in general. A lot of things are already covered in the first two talks, but anyway, I'll go through them quickly. So if we look at the burden in India, 50% of all thalassemia carriers are born only in three countries, India, Thailand, and Indonesia. And 50% of all sickle heterozygotes and homozygous neonates are again born only in three countries, Nigeria, India, and DR Congo. The recent estimates have shown that the expected annual births of beta thalassemias and e-beta thalassemias vary from 10 to 15,000 a year. And for sickle cell disease, which is sickle homozygotes and sickle beta thalassemias mainly, these two, from 37,000 to 42,000. The estimates, we have several estimates, different estimates of patients in the country, and this is one of the recent ones, which says that we have 100 to 150,000 beta thalassemia patients and an equal number of those with sickle cell disease. So hemoglobinopathies are preventable disorders. We have prevention programs been going on in many centers, and yet we have many challenges. We have a very vast country, a population of over 1.3 billion, where the population of each state equals that of different countries. We have a lot of diversity in terms of ethnicity, religions, and 2/3 of our population reside in rural areas with limited awareness, and access to medical facilities is not very easy for them. So the key to a successful prevention or control program is to create awareness in the population. And here it is the NGO groups and parents, patient societies, which play a big role. Obstetricians, of course, are very important, as we've already seen in the first two talks. They must insist that women register early in the first trimester. They must do a CBC, and if the couple is from a community where sickle hemoglobin is common, then a solubility test as well. And this should be done during the first antenatal visit. If the MCB is less than 80 with an MCH less than 27, a high RBC count, and a normal RDW, they must ask for a hemoglobin analysis. This is now these days mostly done by HPLC or capillary electrophoresis, but for sickle hemoglobin, you can still very well use the simple cellulose acetate electrophoresis. And particularly HPLC may not be available in interior areas. So the hallmark of diagnosis of carriers is an elevated A2 level, usually 4 to 8%. So what is a nightmare in counseling and prenatal diagnosis? That is the atypical heterozygotes. That is in a couple where one partner is a classical beta thalassemia trait and the other partner has either reduced or normal red cell indices, has a high RBC count, but the A2 level is either absolutely normal or borderline, usually varying from 3 to 3.9%. And this can lead to a misdiagnosis of carriers. The usual mutations that lead to this sort of situation are the cap site and the poly A mutation in Indians. But we've seen it now with several other common mutations as well. And mostly this is also because heterozygotes who co-inherit delta gene mutation. So if you have a co-inherited delta gene mutation with a beta thalassemia mutation, your A2 will get reduced to normal. And here, over a period of around 5 years, we had about 2.5 to 3% of couples where one of the parents had a classical high A2 while the other partner had an absolutely normal or even a very low A2. One has to be very careful in such cases, and you have to get molecular analysis done. The counseling again is a major, plays a major role for prenatal diagnosis. The counselor must explain the clinical presentation, severity, what are the consequences of the disorder, at the same time maintain confidentiality. The family history has to be documented, including consanguinity. The inheritance pattern should be explained, as well as the risk of recurrence, the 25% risk of recurrence, having an affected child in every pregnancy. The counselor also has to provide all available information, all the options available, and reassure the couple that there is a possibility of them having a healthy child. It's not just pre-test counseling that is important, but post-test counseling after prenatal diagnosis is equally important because the family has to take important decisions, especially if it is an affected baby, and this will help them to eliminate all their irrational fears. And as Dr. Gambhir already pointed out, counselor must put forth the suggestion that the couple needs to have the extended family members tested. That is what we call cascade screening. Now recently, along with Dr. Sujata Sinha and others, we calculated what the projected annual cost of care and prevention be in the year 2026. That is going from 2016 to 2026 over a period of 10 years. So taking an estimated average of 12,500 thalassemia major births annually, by 2026, you would have 275,000 patients, and the blood units required would be double from what they are now, and they would go up to 8.25 million, which is a huge chunk of the blood donation that takes place. The annual cost of care, which is here taking into consideration only transfusion and chelation, works out to 55,000 million rupees. And against that, the cost of screening and prevention would only be a fraction, a little over 2,000 million rupees. So these are disorders where prevention plays a very significant role. A prenatal diagnosis is an integral component of a prevention program to minimize the incidence of new births. And in spite of very extensive screening programs now going on in the country, and we have more than 20 centers for prenatal diagnosis in different regions, yet we haven't been able to bring about a significant reduction in the prevention of births of babies with severe disorders. So who are the couples who require prenatal diagnosis and who don't? Very often, any two carriers, they are just referred for prenatal diagnosis, but we have to remember that if you have couples where both the partners are hemoglobin E carriers, or one is, or both are D carriers, or one is a hemoglobin D and the other is a beta thalassemia carrier, or Q and beta thalassemia, or beta thalassemia HPFH. In all these conditions, the disorder is very mild, and we do not suggest that they should go in for prenatal intervention. But these are all the other disorders where it is required, because these cases are going to have a severe presentation. So the reproductive options for couples at risk are basically three. The first is, of course, what is done and will continue to be done for a long time. That is the conventional prenatal diagnosis. Then we have non-invasive diagnosis and pre-implantation genetic diagnosis. So Dr. Manchanda has already covered some of this. The method of choice is to do CBS anywhere from 10.5 to 12, 13 weeks of gestation and DNA analysis. It is important that the parental mutations must be characterized before fetal tissue sampling, because sometimes if you're not able to identify the mutations, you might do a CBS and not be able to give a diagnosis. So we have a huge number of mutations in India, over 80 mutations, out of which these are the seven which are common, and they cover almost all, 85 to 90% of all the mutations in India. And this just shows different studies showing the distribution of mutation in different regions in the country. And as you can see, the blue, which is IBS15, stands out as the most common in all regions. If they come late, if the couple is referred late, we do amniocentesis at 15 to 16 weeks, pin down the amniotic fluid cells and do a DNA analysis. Or if they come even later, you can do cordocentesis at 18 or 19 weeks and then do a fetal blood analysis. So fetal blood, you can run directly on HPLC. It is quick, it is cheap. You don't need to do a globin biosynthesis anymore. And you look at the amount of adult hemoglobin, that's hemoglobin A0 that is present. If it's a variant hemoglobin, then you look at the proportion of A0 to the variant hemoglobin. So these are some of the techniques which are used for prenatal diagnosis. You have your CVS tissue, you clean it under a dissecting microscope, then you rule out maternal contamination by using different markers, VNTR, STR markers. And generally we use one of two approaches, either a reverse dot blot or an ARMS PCR to identify the mutations. If the mutation remains unidentified, you do a Sanger sequencing. For cordocentesis, the fetal blood can be stained by the Kleihau-Bethke method, and you have to ensure that you have all fetal cells. There should not be a single ghost cell, and then you can go directly for an HPLC. And in this case, you will see that on HPLC, you have just one big peak of hemoglobin F, and hemoglobin A comes up over here, but there is no hemoglobin A in this fetus, so it's a beta homozygous, beta zero thalassemia homozygous fetus. Very important to follow these babies at birth or later after prenatal diagnosis. And here you see a baby which is a sickle carrier, which is still showing high F at birth, but you have adequate amount of A and S. And this is a normal baby, again showing fetal and adequate amount of adult hemoglobin. A prenatal diagnosis is not a replacement for conventional prenatal diagnosis. It is only an option for a few couples. It involves selective transfer of unaffected embryos established after IVF. And it's important mainly for couples who have fertility problems or an unsuccessful reproductive history, or also sometimes for couples where termination of an ongoing pregnancy in case it is affected is not acceptable. Coming to non-invasive prenatal diagnosis, there are two approaches: isolating fetal cells from the maternal blood or cell-free fetal DNA from maternal plasma. The advantage here is you're not endangering the fetus in any way because you are taking a maternal peripheral blood sample. Fetal nucleated cells were the ones where most work has been done. We had also done some work, but there are very few nucleated cells per ml of maternal blood, and thus you're compromising on sensitivity and specificity. Again, these cells persist in the maternal circulation for years sometimes, and that's why it might lead to a misdiagnosis in subsequent pregnancies. So it was Dennis Lowe who found that cell-free fetal DNA in maternal plasma could be used, and this is derived from the placenta. He first showed bichromosomal DNA sequences in the plasma of women who carried male fetuses. And using real-time PCR, it is found that about 3% of cell-free DNA is present in the first and second trimester. Using more sensitive techniques like digital PCR, now we know that about 10% of cell-free DNA is present. And the other advantage is that this can be removed very rapidly. It's removed very rapidly after delivery, so there's no question of there being any contamination in the next pregnancy. And you can do this right from 8 weeks onwards. Many countries are already used routinely. In India, it's still at an experimental stage. So here are some of the challenges we have. CBC not done during the first antenatal visit or not correctly interpreted if done. Couples at risk, often referred late. We need a transition from retrospective to prospective fetal diagnosis. Many couples come after having affected children. And unless we bring about this transmission, we are going to have babies with thalassemia and sickle cell disease continue to be born. We don't have enough trained obstetricians and sonologists for fetal tissue and blood sampling in rural regions. So many couples have to travel to reach a center where they can have prenatal diagnosis done. So we need many more centers in different states. So just a couple of slides about what is happening in the future. A demand for a national policy has come from the patients. And these are the public health goals of the proposed policy: to provide best possible evidence-based treatment for all patients in all states, to reduce the burden by doing efficient control programs, and to integrate both management and control in the existing public health infrastructure. So what is the roadmap ahead? We have, Dr. Gambhir also showed that the guidelines have been formulated and published by the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare in 2016. These are presently being reviewed and updated. Last year, we had some meetings and then the training modules for preparing were prepared for training. And some training with the NHM and Dr. Vinita Srivastav, they have initiated some of the training in some of the states. A draft of the National Policy on Control and Management of Hemoglobinopathies was prepared in 2018. It is being deliberated, not been accepted yet. And the national registries, which are very much needed, have also been initiated both by ICMR as well as NHM. So we are going ahead on the right path, and hopefully, as we go ahead over the next few years, things will improve and we will be able to control hemoglobinopathies and manage them in a much better way. Thank you.
Very good.
Thank you, ma'am. It was indeed a very informative session. It is an expensive treatment line, which you have shown us around 75,000 per patient. So definitely awareness will help and should help. We start with our question answer session. The first question is to Dr. Gambhir. Dr. Gambhir, if you can unmute. Yes. So the first question by Rahi Vaidya is, how is the patient's privacy maintained?
So basically, in the lab, we have got a very detailed form, which is informed to the patient and it's signed by the patient. So it concerns regarding everything that the test patient is going for, then which is the test that we are going to do on her DNA. Then there are concerns regarding the DNA that is taken and what, if, whether she's consenting to have this particular DNA study included in the research paper, if anything is going to be there. If she does not opt for that, then that particular result is not used. And whether this DNA, she allows us to be, the data allowed, she allows us to be kept in our registry. So if that is not consented for by the patient, then that particular DNA is not available for these particular things. Most importantly, we have a cloud reporting system. So a result that is there is seen
only by the reporting lab, reporting person, and by the doctor himself, and not by anybody else. So this is how we ensure that the privacy of the patient is maintained, as well as the DNA studies that we carry on the particular patient are kept private.
Thank you, sir. Sir, our next question is for you itself. Is there any screening program going on at Osmanabad district?
No, to the best of my knowledge, no screening program is going on. I do not participate in, any government screening program that is going on in Osmanabad.
Okay, thank you, sir. The next question is for Ruma, ma'am. Ruma, ma'am, you're...
Yes, I'm here.
Yes. Ma'am, there is a question from Pooja Doshi, ma'am.
Yes.
They're asking, most of the patients suffer with liver impairment. Any remedies for early management of this issue?
Basically, it is the number of transfusions which are there without chelation. If you are chelating your children well, if you are taking out their iron, which usually damages the liver, then it is liver sparing. So the whole crux of the matter is, whenever you are transfusing, keep an eye on the ferritin level and do an adequate chelation for those children so that they do not deposit iron in different organs, including liver.
Okay. Ma'am, there is another question from Richa Ashma. They're asking, anyone working on cell-free fetal DNA for antenatal diagnosis? This will be a non-invasive method.
Dr. Kola has been doing some work on this, I think. I think she will be the right person to answer this question.
Dr. Kola, if you can take the question.
Okay, we had done some work some years back, but that was using older technologies, and we were able to achieve an accuracy of around 80 to 85% as compared to conventional methods. So unless you reach 100%, it is not, we can't start using it. But now, of course, there are many newer technologies like relative mutation dosage, relative haplotype dosage, and digital PCR technologies. So using those, the sensitivity and specificity will increase. I am not really aware of any center who is currently offering this as a service. Some work is going on this with Dr. Reena Das at Chandigarh, but I don't know if they're offering it as a service yet.
Ruma, ma'am, yes, Dr. Gambhir.
In case of non-invasive prenatal testing, it is easy when husband and wife have got a different mutation. But when they are carrying the same mutation, especially which is common with consanguineous couples, then it is quite different. So nowhere in the world presently is the non-invasive prenatal diagnosis for thalassemia is validated. So presently non-invasive prenatal diagnosis is validated only for aneuploidies. Aneuploidies means Down syndrome, trisomy 13, 18, and sex chromosome. For rest of them, it is still under studies. And second thing, it is not NIPD, I must mention here. It is non-invasive prenatal screening. So like in PGS and PGD, when we have diagnosis, it is from a single cell. So as to have accurate result, it is always recommended that you proceed on to an invasive method. For example, you have a normal PGD for a thalassemia patient or a HDS patient. It is recommended that you confirm it with amniocentesis, whether it is actually so. So that is why these methods are still under evaluation. And they are not as well established as our conventional prenatal diagnosis with amniocentesis or CVS.
Thank you, sir. Ruma, ma'am, there is a question. Allo antibodies development in patients due to recurrent blood transfusions is also observed. Yes. Do we have any measures followed to take care of this?
Normally, we do the extended cross-matching can be done so that you can find out these antibodies and select those donors who match very well. It is very difficult, little expensive, but yes, it is possible to select these donors.
Okay, there is another question from Mr. Sadanand Nayak. He is asking, subjects referred to HbA1c are observed to have HbS trait. Your opinion about it?
Yes, you can catch these in your HbA1c, which is also HPLC method, basically. So you can pick up the other abnormal hemoglobins in this technique also. But I think it should be confirmed by the proper HPLC of hemoglobin. You can pick up sickle, confirm by doing sickling. And you can pick up other abnormal hemoglobins as well. But you need to confirm with the proper hemoglobin HPLC.
Okay. Last question for you, ma'am. Is there any kit available for CFF DNA isolation?
I'm not aware of it because I don't do any DNA isolations, so I have no idea.
Yes, there are some kits now which are available.
Dr. Kola, yes, ma'am.
They are available. There are from few companies which are marketing such kits.
Ma'am, Kola, ma'am, there is a question for you. Do you have parents coming to you for antenatal screening? Any subsidy given to the patients since yours is an ICMR unit?
Yeah, they have. They are not, most of them have a minimal charge to pay, or many of them are also free.
Any later subsidy for the treatment line, ma'am?
That we are not involved, I mean, in my institute, they were not involved in treatment. So we were not involved with that aspect.
Okay. But, okay. Ma'am, there is an open question here for anybody to answer. What steps should be taken for mandatory genotype test during pregnancy? Is there any national registry available in India for SCD?
I don't think there is any national registry available so far. At least I'm not aware of it. No national registry for this. And okay. Testing for genotypes, of course, as I said, there is no certain organization which is doing in an organized manner. We are not doing it.
Okay.
But Dr. Kola will know more because she's involved in...
Yeah, I don't think there's any national registry. The National Registry of Patients is now being initiated.
Yeah.
I don't think we have a national registry of mutations. So we have a database of Indian mutations called Thalind, where these mutations can be put in.
Okay, ma'am, there is a open question. Is there any thought of interdisciplinary researches in hemoglobinopathies where Maharashtra Arogya Mandal is trying to improve the status of patients of sickle cell distress? I think Baba will be able to talk about it. Ayurvedic research and the other conventional research. Is there a common ground, interdisciplinary research going on?
There's no research, but yes, many things are being tried. Like in sickle, they're trying to increase the amount of fetal hemoglobin. So it's basically increasing the amount of fetal hemoglobin, which will help the sickle patients not to sickle so often. So these many medicines are being tried. Some Ayurvedic medicines are there. Certain compounds are there which are being used. And they are having good effects. They are protecting these sicklers from having clinical sort of remission. They don't go into clinical severe defects.
Okay.
So, but I don't think there is any research, definite research going on, which I think we should do in India. Because a lot of, we have Ayurvedic colleges and a lot of Ayurvedic products are there. The unfortunate part is that many people, I mean, they're not knowing, they're just trying these. But many end up with certain other complications.
Correct.
I think we need to regulate them.
The last question of the session, on a lighter note, somebody has written, actor Amitabh Bachchan is a beta thalassemia carrier, but he was COVID case positive. Can you please highlight?
he recovered also very fast.
Yes, sir.
His age, he could recover uneventfully. So maybe that is because of his career state.
Yes, I think you're right.
Yes. So we come to the end of this session. I have to do the thank you session also. So let's go ahead for it. On behalf of SKRF management and staff, I would like to thank our distinguished speakers of today's webinar, Dr. Mrudula Phadke, Dr. Prakash Gambhir, Dr. Ruma Manchanda, and Dr. Roshan Kola. A big thank you. A big thank you to all our participants who took time off their busy schedule to attend this seminar. Last but not the least, I thank the technical team of SKRF, that is Rahul Jaiswal, Amitabh Mehta, Shruti Kate, Samir Kate, and Swati Mane. I have come to this conclusion that the power of prenatal diagnosis goes a long way in preemptive mitigation of suffering and provides ethical choices to society. So I hope this awareness webinar is going to help the society and our clinicians and our gynecologists. So thank you so much, everybody, for making this webinar a success. Thank
you. Before we end, we have a small poll.
Yes, sir.
The small poll for everyone to answer, if you can take 1 minute to answer this. You can just click on the poll that is being put on the screen.
Yes. Yes.
So we have two questions for everyone. How was the seminar? And would you love to have more such seminars? And how many of you would love to volunteer? Your answers will be really valuable for us. Thank you so much.
And it's 100%. Okay.
I'm sharing the results.
So, Ruma ma'am, it was indeed a wonderful idea. 100% people want it.
Thank you.
And we have a lot of volunteers also, 69%. So that's wonderful. We will make use of everybody who is ready to volunteer.
Sure, that's good.
And maybe we can change the maybe category. 10%. Thank you so much and have a good day and a safe future.
Thank you very much.
Congratulations, Kate sir.
Thank you.
It was a wonderful seminar. Congratulations to all the speakers and faculty also.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you, everyone.
Meta sir, you can.